Bhavatu Sahanaum Bhunattu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai Shanti 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 Gurur Brahma Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Samasta Jana Kalyane Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram Hari Om. So, 7 steps we have seen so far, and as per the science of Vedanta, these 7 steps are the preparation for contemplation. Our purpose of practicing contemplation is to undo the wrong notions that we have about ourselves, and through that to reach the state of infinite bliss or happiness, which is our true nature, which is called Sat Chit Anand. That state is the state of meditation. And the only way to reach there is contemplation. Whichever path one takes. If it is yoga, it is dharana, then dhyan, that is contemplation, then samadhi, which is meditation. Even in bhakti, the 10th chapter, the Lord says in the Gita, Dadami buddhi yogam tam. I bless the devotee with the buddhi yoga, meaning the knowledge of the self. Yena mam upayanti te, by which they will experience oneness with me. And jnana yoga, definitely, the path is shravan, manan and nidhyasana. So, as far as a Vedantic student is concerned, the main sadhana is Shravan Manan Nididhyasana. So, in sadhana there are layers of sadhana. If we understand that, then we also know the way to progress. The outermost periphery is, if you have read Bhaja Govindam, I'm just going to use examples from Bhaja Govindam to understand the different layers, or different ways to understand it otherwise, but we have done, many of us, Bhaja Govindam. So in Bhaja Govindam there is one shloka which says, Geyam Gita Nama Sahasram Dheyam Shripati Rupam Ajasram Dheyam Gita Nama Sahasram Dheyam Shripati Rupam Ajasram Dheyam Dina Janaya Chavittam Neyam Sajjana Sange Chittam. So satsang, dan, you know, the form of the Lord, chanting, fasting, pilgrimage, all those are the external or the outer layer of sadhana. That is called Bahiranga sadhana. Outer means more simpler and which involves more external support. So you walk and go to the temple, you open the book, you chant loudly and then you have some dan, then different levels of sadhana, external. Subtler than that is called Antaranga sadhana. So the shloka for that is Pranayamam pratyaharam nitya nitya viveka vicharam japya sameta samadhi vidhanam kuru avadhanam mahadavadhanam. So pranayam, pratyahar, doing japa, all these are internal sadhanas, more subtler, where external props are lesser. Then there is direct sadhana. So the direct sadhana is that which will lead straight to self-realization. These other two sadhans will prepare us. The means to realization straight is nitya, anitya, viveka, vichar. That path from vivek, vairagya, shatka, sampati, mumukshutvam, preparation, then comes shravan, mana, nididhyasana. That is called sakshat sadhan. Direct means. This shravan, manana, nididhyasana, when a person follows, that wrong ideas about I that we have, I am so and so, son of so and so, and I am happy, I am sad, I am successful, those notions, the limited notions that we have, they will all get undone. Now what happens to us is we study Vedanta and then straight away we want the experience of Sakshatkar. That Bahirang Sadhan, Antarang Sadhan, then Sakshat Sadhan, that is not followed in the steps. So the preparation is not done, the readiness is not there. It's like sitting in a PhD class without passing graduation also. How will one understand? One is not going mad, thank the Lord for that. Otherwise, suddenly we come to Vedanta and we say this world is not... See, to understand Vedanta, that world is an illusion, that itself is difficult. Advanced Vedanta and highest level of Vedanta will say world was not even created. We can't accept that situation only. That our nature is Sat, Chit, Anand, infinite reality is our true nature. No possibility to experience that because the preparation is not done. So far what all we have done is different levels of sadhana to prepare for this main one, which is called Nididhyasana or contemplation. This eighth point. And after this comes Sakshi Bhav. Nowadays people want to jump straight Sakshi Bhav. What are you doing? I don't believe in any of the practice. I am a Sakshi. More about that I will come to when we do the next class, Sakshi Bhav. Okay, what is Sakshi Bhav and how does it even happen? So, very nice line here. Man is what he believes and is limited by his beliefs because he believes in the limited. Our belief is only in the limited things. Happiness is outside, happiness with this person, happiness is in that situation. That limited belief system when we have, there will be dependency, there will be sorrow, there will be fear, there will be insecurity, there will be stress. Now and then we will feel happiness also, it comes and goes. But what gives us fulfillment, that we don't experience. The emptiness will continue to remain. Somebody who has thought about this very well, that no matter what I do, I still remain a finite individual. There's a limitation. I feel bound. I feel incomplete. That person will focus on the study of Vedanta, because that's the only way to undo these wrong notions. It is not that we are finite and we have to become infinite. It's just that we have forgotten that we are infinite. Because we have identified with this body. So the higher levels of sadhana are to undo the wrong notions. It is not to create anything new. It is like the sun is already there, the clouds are covering it. The clouds have to move. So the wrong notions in our mind have to go. We don't have to create infinite reality, that's our nature already. The waker is already there. The dreamer does not have to do sadhana to produce a waker or to become the waker. The dreamer has to wake up, understand that I am not that dream character. That's what the dreamer has to do. Hence, these psychological beliefs are what hold us back. So there's a very simple story that there was this elephant which was born and brought up in an environment where the parent was in the circus. So the elephant is born in that circus. And that elephant from childhood has been growing up there and has been trained and does a lot of these various feats in the show. So one day the friend of this circus manager comes and he says, you know, he's going around and he sees the elephant is tied with one iron chain. So the friend asks him that, how come this huge and mighty elephant is tied by this iron chain? It's very easy for the elephant to just break away and become free. But how does it continue to stay here? So the friend tells him this, that it is because the elephant believes that it can be tied down by this chain because it has grown up with that belief. Now, same is our situation. We have been told from childhood that we are this entity and we continue to believe. Though there is an infinite reality within each one of us, and though it is possible that we can break free from the wrong notions, and for that one doesn't have to go anywhere else. Right where one is staying, one can undo the thoughts in one's own mind. It's here. So Vedanta is that science which helps me to undo those thoughts. If you know the BMI chart, body, mind, intellect, perceiver, feeler, thinker, object, emotion and thought, in that PFT, perceiver, feeler and thinker, is that ego. To drop that ego, I have to understand what is that reality and contemplate on that. Hence, we say that these are some of the limiting beliefs that we have, that I am this body. This body is actually an equipment, but I feel I am this body. Or that the world is real. All the false notions that we have are boiling down to only these two. I am the body and the world is real. Everything else is an expression of these two. Because I think the world is real, I think it has capacity to make me happy, so I run behind it. And because I think I am the body, happiness of the body is my happiness, and so again I run behind something which makes this body happy. Same thing with mind, same thing with intellect. Body means all the three. Hence, many of these notions that I am born into this world, happiness is from outside, this individual, this ego is me, these are my things, my people, these are all psychological beliefs that limit us. One aspect is the functional beliefs. That is the fact that we have a body and we are born in a particular family, we have some people with us who are my father, mother, children, wife, all that. That is not a bondage. That is not a problem. The problem is that I believe these to be real, that I am this only, and I define myself based on this. Then I get bound. Vedanta says that these are all questionable. Are we aware that I have a body in the state of deep sleep? Not aware. The world also disappears in deep sleep. Why in deep sleep? Even in that time when we are working, fully absorbed the mind is, we forget time, we forget place where we are, we forget our body. So, as long as the attachment is there to this equipment, this identification is there with this body, mind, intellect, so long the world will appear very real. So Vedanta says how to remove that attachment. A very nice shloka in Atmabodh, Shankaracharya ji wrote, he says, Ajnana Kalusham Jivam Jnana Bhyasad Vinirmalam. Because of ignorance, because of lack of knowledge, we don't know that our nature is supreme happiness and peace. How will that taint of ignorance go? Jnana Abhyasat Nirmalam. Practice of Jnan Abhyas. Jnan Abhyas is Shravan Manan Nididhyasan. And the analogy he has given there is, it is like dirty water. Kritva jnanam svayam nashyet jalam katakarenu vat. So early, in the earlier days, ancient days, if there is water which is impure, there is the powder of kataka nut. You know, it is made into a powder and that is sprinkled on it. So it will form a little thicker film and it will go down. And as it goes down, it will collect all the impurities and it will settle down. Something like an alum which we long back we used to use, put in water. And after some time the whole thing will settle down. And you filter up the water from the top. So he says, like that, the knowledge, the practice of knowledge will remove the taint of ignorance. Now the example has a limitation. Don't say that, but it is still there. From top it has come down. That's the limitation of the example. Idea is that it will settle down and it will get removed. The impurity will get cleared. So this practice is of three steps. And these three steps, we should never, never underestimate the power of these three steps. As Vedantic students, we always underestimate the power. But this is the main sadhana. Like see, in Bhakti Shastra, they will say that name of the Lord is most powerful. And don't ever underestimate the power of the Lord's name. But we underestimate that also. Because they are very simple, no? Just keep doing japa. But such a powerful method it is to realize the truth. Same way in Gyan, it is Shravan Manan Nididhyasan. So what will Shravan do? First and foremost, Shravan will remove the ignorance, meaning basic intellectual awareness which I don't have right now, that will go. So that obstacle called I don't know, that goes. At least now I know, when I'm listening to Vedanta, I know that happiness is not outside. World outside is an illusion. How happiness is my nature. Listening has removed at least those that ignorance in terms of not being aware. Don't expect that by itself this will do anything. It can also. If the mind is ready, it will do. But the mind is not ready most of our cases. So the next step is, when I listen to Vedanta, there will naturally be doubts because Vedanta will challenge my deep-rooted belief system. No, nothing else will challenge my deep-rooted belief system as powerfully as Vedanta will challenge. And that's why those who study Vedanta, they are on a greatest adventure. Because they have to let go, and let go of the deepest belief system, which is I am the body. So the second obstacle is, I can't understand, how is it that I am not this body? How is it that the world is an illusion? There will be doubts. So the second sadhana is manan, which will help me to remove these doubts, that I can't understand. Everybody has taught me this, I am the body. Now you are saying you are not the body. But I have to understand that and live with the body all the time. So using logic, one will remove the doubts. So I can't understand will go when I reflect more and more and more. Many people do the first thing. Then they stop. They say, "Hum to Vedanta bahut suna hai, kuch nahi hua." Nothing will happen. Because the second step has to be followed up now. The manan has to be done. And there is a pattern, there is a method to do manan. How to do that, I will come a little more later. Then comes the third step, where even if I am intellectually convinced, I don't feel that. At bhavana level, that is contemplation, where I change, that I don't experience this. So the practice of contemplation is to reverse this feeling, that intellectually I have complete conviction and no doubts. Absolutely no doubts. But at experience level, I still feel I am a jiva. Nididhyasana comes in that situation there. So these three steps, Shravan, Manan, Nididhyasana, they are very, very important and very powerful. In Vedanta, if these three steps we focus on, realization is sure. But it has to follow these three steps. One can't skip, jump, hop, not possible. So now I'll go a little more detail into it. What is listening? Shravanam. Even in our day-to-day life, Shravanam is very important. More than 40% of the product innovations in a company happen because they listen to the customers, to the people, workers, to shareholders. One has to listen. In a relationship, to make the person feel loved and appreciated, one has to listen. The problem is many places one doesn't listen, there's no listening happening. Vedanta also listening is very important. And we listen not only with ears, we listen with our whole being. Specifically here is about, listening is about what we hear through the ears. But if I am fully available, I can listen with my whole being. With my eyes I can see the non-verbal communication, and that's a message that I am listening. So listening has a very important role to play. Traditionally it is said, you have to listen from a Sadguru or somebody who is Shrotriya and Brahmanishtha. One who is well versed in the scripture or the science of Vedanta, and one who has the experience. If it is difficult to find somebody with experience, at least listen to somebody who has studied and understood the Shastra systematically. Listen to a Guru. Listen to the teachings of Vedanta specifically about who is the Self, that Shravan of my true nature. And when I listen, I have to listen with complete alertness and awareness. That time the mind should not wander. It is said in Vedanta that if one listens with complete alertness and attention, realization will be instant. If you see the seekers of the Upanishads, they don't go back home, they don't have a study group weekly to reflect, none of that. Nachiketa was given the knowledge by Yamraj, straight, realization is then and there, instant. Vedanta is more instant than anything instant in this world, faster than 2 minute Maggie also. Somebody asked Ramana Maharshi, how long does it take to realize? He said, not even the time taken for you to blink your eye. Janak Maharaj asked Ashtavakra Muni, how much time will it take to realize? He said, not even the time taken by you when you put your foot in one saddle of the horse, and before you turn around and put on the next, before that you can realize. And literally Janak Maharaj realized like that. But why does it not happen to us? Preparation is required. The long sadhana is to bring that mind to that point of stillness, focus, purity, and then you listen instant. So, listening with alertness. You know, in Sandipani when we were studying, every morning 7 o'clock there is a class, and evening 4 o'clock there is a class, evening 7 there is a satsang. And there are people who will get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, and they will do japa, they will do puja, they will do chanting and what not they will do. But in the 7 o'clock class, they will feel sleepy. That is the main sadhana actually, to listen carefully. So in our life, the organizing of our priorities and sadhana must be such that for Shravan, I am fresh and fully available. And I prepare myself. So when one listens, what is the result? How do I know I have heard, I have done my listening properly? There's a nice book called Vedant Sar, written by Swami Sadananda. In that he says, Shravanam Nama Tatpari Avadharanam. Determination of the truth is called Shravan. That what is the essence, what is the truth? This you can apply in anything. You take a book and you read. The essence of that one should grasp. Then I have done the reading well. If I watch a video on YouTube, I have to grasp the essence. Not some secondary points or some joke or some... What is the crux, the essence? If that I determine, then I have done my Shravanam well. There's one person who went to attend a lecture, and after 1.5 hours the lecture got over, he came back home and the wife asked him, so what did the speaker speak on? A person said, oh, that the topic he didn't say only. There are people who are like that. Now we don't know whether he didn't listen properly or that speaker went all over the place, but the point is that essence has to be determined. Especially in the scriptural study. Suppose I ask you, what is the essence of Bhagavad Gita? What will you say? Many of you have studied the Bhagavad Gita. So what is the essence of Bhagavad Gita? No, way of life, no. What is that? Essence. Bhakti, karma yoga, surrender. Self-knowledge, action without results, do your duty, many things we can say. But the crux of Gita, is Gita Dharma Shastra or Moksha Shastra? Lot of people believe it is Dharma Shastra, but actually it is a Moksha Shastra. So if I studied the Gita properly, then I will know that the essence of the Gita is to give me the knowledge of the self. To make Arjun fight or do his duty, Bhagavan could have given him a nice pep talk. He would have gone and done it. Crux of the Gita is self-knowledge. What is the crux of, let us say, Ramayana? Follow your dharma uncompromisingly. What is the essence of Bhagavat? Bhakti is the essence. So surrender to the Lord is the essence of Bhagavat. Bhagavat dharma is that sarva dharman parityajya, that Gita shloka is a Bhagavat dharma actually. So if I determine the essence, then I have done the shravanam well. So when I study any book, or I study so many texts one after the other, what is the essence? And when I listen to the teacher, I must be able to determine intellectually the essence is I am Brahman. So the determination of the essence, that there is Brahman alone which is the truth, everything else is an illusion, and I am that Brahman. It's not that there is one Brahman and that is the truth. The essence is I am that Brahman in my true nature. This is only an equipment that I have. Then I have done Shravanam very well. If that Shravanam has not happened well, the Mananam cannot happen. So one aspect is I have to listen, understand the essence. Naturally there will be doubts in that. So Mananam will be to ensure that those doubts get cleared. That is the second step, is I have to reflect. You know, very interesting is the method of gaining knowledge. There is a nice shloka which says, knowledge is gained in four quarters. 25% of knowledge is gained when we listen to the teacher. Acharyat padamadatte. Only 25% by listening. Padam shishya swamedhaya. Next 25% by one's own reflection. Padam sab brahmacharibhya. Third 25% is when I discuss with the fellow students. And the fourth one, padam kala kramena cha, is in time one will understand. One has to mature through time. In these four stages, knowledge is gained. Any knowledge. And the subtler the knowledge, more this will come into play. So the second step in Vedanta, that's why, is reflection. And how to reflect? Using the logic of the scripture, which is a time-tested logic. See, logic is a double-edged sword. We should know that. Just because something is proved by logic doesn't mean it is a fact. Simple example, which we all of you know. I love the professor. Professor loves his daughter. So I love the daughter of the professor. How can it be? Mathematically, logically is proper, na? Logically you can prove God exists, and logically you can prove God does not exist. And equally powerful arguments one can give. In one of the sessions we had a debate. God does not exist, God exists. Both are powerful arguments. Which logic to follow? In this country of ours, one of the beauty of our culture is vada, means discussion. Shankaracharya revived the whole Hindu culture on the basis of discussions. And the people who used to discuss, they had that open mind that if I am defeated and you are able to convince me properly, I will drop my false notions and I will accept what you are saying, because that's the truth. There was no ego, and you know, I will hold back to my notions only. No. That's the way the whole culture has been, where questioning was encouraged, discussion was encouraged, and there was a freedom not to believe also. Hence, one has to reflect using scriptural logic. Otherwise, there's a lot of flaw, because logic can be used either ways, and also that human mind can build logic to suit its own conclusion. There are two ways. Either you can logically follow step by step and come to a conclusion, or do the other way, like how we do in our maths exam. We know the conclusion and then write backwards. So then conclude already and then build some supportive logic, which will not take us far. So one has to understand this, that use the scriptural logic, clear the doubts about Brahman, about world, the reality and all that. An interesting thing is, this scriptural logic is so beautiful, eventually science comes to scriptural logic. That's the beauty of that. How many thousands of years ago they said that this world is an illusion and it is only made up of Anu and Paramanu, atom and subatomic particles. Kanada Rishi said that. Now science has come to that, atom, then subatomic particles and quantum physics and so many other things. It's only a question of time. This is a time-tested wisdom. So using scriptural logic, and so Gurudev created a scheme of study for us, step by step by step, and do the discussion in the class, so that using logic I can reflect. What is the result of reflection? I must get complete intellectual conviction that nobody should be able to shake me from that. That yes, there is a reality which is Brahman and that is me. And the world is definitely an illusion. That intellectual conviction is very important. Because only when I understand that very clearly that it is an illusion. No, but it is looking very real. In a desert, that's what happens. No? When a seasoned traveler is going in the desert, will he see a mirage or not? He will also see a mirage. And a first timer who is going, he will also see a mirage. But what is the difference in the conviction? The seasoned traveler knows that that is a mirage. That one can't avoid. Seeing the mirage, one can't avoid. So if one believes that because I think world is an illusion, this world will cease to exist, that will not happen. But when I know something is an illusion, I will not chase. The seasoned traveler never runs behind that mirage for water. So if I know that this is an illusion, I will not run behind it. And the moment I know this is an illusion, my attention will go to what is the truth. If this is an illusion, then what is the truth? Today, because the world is considered as the truth, that question also doesn't arise, that what is the truth and what is the reality. And when Vedant raises that question, one says, hey, what a question that is. It's so obvious this is the truth. Because I am convinced by what my senses are telling me. And my senses have such terrible limitation. Ears cannot hear sounds beyond a certain, what is that, 20,000, what is the unit?
Decibels.
Eyes can't see beyond a range. Ultraviolet, infrared, we can't see only. They have such limitations. And even what we are seeing, that whole concept of light years is like that. 5,000 light years, meaning that star which I am seeing is 5,000 years old. It may not even be existing. So what I see can't be real. It is to be understood properly. It has a certain limitation and certain relevance, but beyond that it doesn't have any solid, tangible existence. So if I use scriptural logic, I get convinced, my chase will stop. Only if the chase stops, can I contemplate steadily. Hence the importance of listening and reflection and vairagya. If I consider the world as real, I cannot have vairagya. It is not possible only. Because it will go behind. Our mind will run behind that. But if I understand it's a mirage, it's an illusion, it appears, I can play with it without being affected. So that intellectual conviction must happen. So all my study group discussions that I do, it should not just be a feel-good factor. You know, we feel very good 1 week, once we all meet and we discuss so nicely, and you know, the week passes very nice after that. And we feel so positive about life and we feel so good, which is fine. There's one level of benefit, there's no doubt, which is good also. Don't stop there. Has it transformed me? Did I become a sadhak? Did it make me realize that I am a seeker of truth and this is only a role that I'm playing? Did it make me consistent? Did it give me that conviction that yes, that Brahman is me? Then that study group, that manan has served the purpose. You see, the difference between a person who reaches the truth fast is not time, it is the intensity of reflection. Vivekananda met Ramakrishna Paramahamsa in 1884. 1886, Ramakrishna passed away. 2 years' time. Gurudev met Tapon Maharaj 1949. 1951, he came down to start the Gita talks. 2 years. Nisargadatta Maharaj met him only for a few days and he did not even know who is the Guru. The Guru came to his house knocking. He was running a provision store and he was living his life. And he stayed, the Guru stayed with him for a few days. They used to have satsang. And when the Guru went, he said, refuse to believe that you are this body, you are not this body. And the Guru went, and after that he has never met the Guru again. Realized. Continuing his work in his family, in his business, whatever he was doing. But internally, with that understanding and faith, that I am not this body. Over. Realized. So it's the intensity of manan. Buddha, Siddhartha, he saw old age, disease and death. Generally we know these three, but fourth thing he saw. That after he saw old age, disease and death, and his charioteer was a very wise man. The charioteer did not say that this is an old man and stop there. The charioteer said, this is an old man and one day you will also become old. This is a sick person and one day you will also get sickness. And this is a dead person, one day you will also die. Because he was living in one bubble. And that bubble burst. Then he met a sannyasi. He said, why are you like this? He has shaved his hair and, you know, wearing some ochre robe, sitting below a tree. Then sannyasi told him, what is purnatva? What is fulfillment? Why one has to go beyond desire? All that. He actually got the knowledge from that sannyasi, but again he was not fully ready for that. But he did his reflection and he decided and he left. That reflection made him transform into a seeker. And after so many years, more than 22, 23 years, he came to the same truth which the sannyasi had told him. But that was his conclusion now, it was not a borrowed knowledge. That desire is a root cause of evil. So a person who does reflection will become ready for contemplation. In meditation, if my mind is wandering, it is only because I have given that importance to that world, to that object, to that person, and so the mind will run there. Janak Maharaj did not move from the place when Ashtavakra Muni was giving the satsang, even when the Mithila supposed to be on fire. So that's his conviction. That was a leela that he did, our Ashtavakra Muni did. So a person who has that conviction will be able to steadily contemplate. And so manan is to be done using the scriptural logic, and the result of manan must be an intellectual conviction and transformation that yes, I am that. Then only we come to the last step, which is contemplation. Where I must contemplate on Brahman. That Aham Brahmasmi, Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. So many of these statements are there. One should contemplate on that. What is the contemplation? It is a direct experience of transcending the BMI and all the limiting beliefs that I have. It is constantly holding on to the thought that I am Brahman. It is not a mantra to be repeated. It is to lift the mind to that state that I am not this, I am that. It is like this. Suppose I say, Prakash, come here. What will happen? In this audience, if there is somebody called Prakash, that person will come. What that person has done? Did the person feel that somebody called Prakash is being called? No. Did the person feel that some Prakash means knowledge, light? So that light has been called? No. So the word is dropped, the meaning of the word is dropped. But what does that word indicate? That word indicates that person. So the person feels that I am Prakash and I am being called. So when we use the word Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham, the word is only a pointer. What does that Chidananda indicate? That pure consciousness and bliss. That is my true nature. So the contemplation is, I am that pure consciousness. So I am dropping the word, I am dropping the meaning. That state of consciousness which is indicated, where I lift the mind to that state, beyond my attachment to the people, beyond my body, all that. That state, I abide in that state. Slowly, slowly that mind will let go of all the false notions. This repeated practice of contemplation is what will lead a person to samadhi. Samadhi is not a trance where mind becomes quiet. Dhi means buddhi. Sama means equanimous. This buddhi has the notion of ego or ahankar. That notion of ahankar becomes dissolved. Ego goes up and down, but the self is equanimous. That ego gets lost in that self. There is one consciousness within us which doesn't change at all. With all the ups and downs of the mind, that consciousness is only a witness of that. I am that consciousness. That understanding, mind has to be lifted to that state. So that is process of contemplation, where I detach from the false and attach to the truth. If some of you are new to this whole concept of Vedanta, you are getting introduced to it, how much ever you can understand that, in time you will get the deeper aspects of that. But many of you have studied Vedanta systematically. So we should know the importance of this, Shravan, Manan and Nididhyasana. Repeat. Huh. So the samadhi part is where, see, the intellect of ours has the notion of the ego. I, Mr. So-and-so, achievements, all the psychological bundle of memories and thoughts is what the ego is. And that ego goes up and down. It gets elated, it gets excited, it gets scared, it gets nervous, all that happens to the ego. Using the contemplation on Brahman, I merge that ego or I dissolve that ego. So that dhi is called as the buddhi and sama is Brahman. So that buddhi, it's like the salt doll going into the ocean and becomes one with that ocean. It's like that the buddhi will just merge as though or dissolve itself into the understanding that I am Brahman. So through constant contemplation, the false notions, when they dissolve, the realization of the truth happens. And this repeated practice of samadhi has to happen for us to actually undo the wrong notions. It takes time and it takes a lot of intensity. Then that person gets established in the self. Having established in that state, one never forgets that I am that true self. But till that abidance or establishment, which is called as nishtha or atmanishtha, that person will come and go, come and go. That fluctuation will keep happening. One will contemplate, one will experience, one will become very quiet, the ego will become lesser and lesser. Again one will come out of that state. Because once on past karma and pressure will push the person out. Again that sadhana is to go back. The sadhana in the world is to live with the attitude of service and humility so that the ego doesn't get increased. This practice of karma yoga, practice of single-pointedness and then this contemplation, when it is done for a sustained period of time, with that feeling that yes, I want to know that truth, the person will know the truth. So these are the three steps. And remember what this Vedantic knowledge will do to us is it is not a relief, it is a permanent cure. It is not that, you know, some specific relief is given for fear, do this, this, this. For anger, do this, this, this. Those methods are there. We have seen that earlier also. And they will help also. But Vedanta doesn't stop there. Vedanta goes to the root cause of all the impurities, and the root cause of all of them is ego. Root cause of ego is I don't know myself. So the knowledge which is given to us in Vedanta is the deepest knowledge which will transform me from the core and cure me from my ignorance. Ignorance is the cause of all sorrows in life. Ignorance leads to desire, desire leads to attachment, anger, fear, all those effects. How to remove that ignorance? That's why to have a Sadguru who can give us knowledge of Vedanta is the greatest blessing. Shankaracharya ji writes that. And if you have a Sadguru in your life, you have a human birth and you have intense desire to seek liberation, these are three signs of the grace of the Lord in our life. Two of them we already have. It's only a question that third one, the intensity we have to increase with our self-effort. So especially in this centenary year of Gurudev, just imagine what he did for us. 42 years he struggled and he did so much of effort to bring this knowledge to us. And this knowledge is the crux of Hindu culture. Everything in Hindu culture revolves around this knowledge. So if I understand that, I will give enough priority to Vedanta. It will bring me relief, but it will more importantly help me to work on the cure. And the incompleteness goes away. The cycle of birth and death, desire, fulfillment, dependency, all that goes away. So here, just see a nice video of Gurudev on this. This is the last verse of 15th chapter where he gives a beautiful analogy of a coffee and he explains the Shravan Manan Nididhyasan beautifully through that.
Shastram
Iti Bhujyatamam Shastram
Idamuktam Mayanagha
Idamuktam Mayanagha
Etad Buddhva Buddhimam Chyad
Etad Buddha Buddhimam Chyad
Krita Krityascha Bharata
Krita Krityascha Bharata
Iti Das. Das means in the last 19 verses.
Guhyatamam.
Guhya, secret. Guhyatara, more secret. Guhyatama, most secret. Comparative and superlative. So, Guhyatama, the highest secret. Idam, Shastram, Idam, Uptam. Shastram, science. This highest secret science of reality. Idamuktam, I have already told you. Maya, by me, he anagha. Oh, attentive student who is bringing all his mind in single-pointed attention. Etat buddhva, having understood what I said so far intellectually. Buddhiman syad, may you become a buddhiman, a wise man. It is unnecessary repetition, isn't it? Having known this, may you be a wise man. Hey! It's because You come from the office ready to fight with anybody, including your wife, because that is the only place where you can really fight. In any other place, you know, they may give you back. Here there is nothing. It's a Hindu wife. And nothing there in the house that I can quarrel with. Everything spick and span, spit and polished, everything. I am choking to bring out my repressions and suppressions in my office and in the marketplace, the disappointments and dejections, the insults that I received and the unjustifiable kicks that I got in life. I want to pour it out, but there's no chance. And as soon as I sat down on the table, that tea came. If it is late, I can howl. You did not know that I am coming here. Why didn't you prepare? She is preparing the tea in the kitchen. And if she had brought the tea, that is sufficient. If she is well dressed, why are you dressed up like that? If you are not dressed up, can't you not at least take a bath and drink up? Don't you know that I am coming? Look like a devil? Somewhere. So she knows it by her experience of last 20 years. So she selected the youngest child. Baby, go and give it to Papa. Now you can't howl at him because he will not understand. You will just look at him. Observing and watching the ugliness on your face. He won't understand. And if you are talking too long for him, he will suck his thumb. He will not understand. So it's useless. You kept it there. You lifted the cup and seen whether it is spilt in the cup. Then that is true. No, it is not spilt. You looked at all the sides of the cup, it is all clean. Okay. You lifted it. Very disappointed, because you know, he has not been able to give. The moment that tea touched your lips, ha, got a chance, you kept that cup there and started howling at the wife. Can't you not give me some sugar? Am I not the earning member? Am I not feeding you every time? Can't you not give me some sugar? Maybe in your house, your parents have taught you how to drink without sugar. In my house, it is not so. From childhood onwards, we have been taking sugar. Went on and on and on, and she always allows you to go on. Why? It is a relief for you. At the end of it, when you are silent, she says, I have put sugar in it. That is sufficient. Another wave of, you have put sugar, as if I don't know the taste of sugar. Maybe you don't know the taste of sugar, because in your house you never got to taste. It is only after coming to my house that you have taken a lot of it. She allows you. So in the two waves, you know, half of, or more than half of the suppressions have gone. Then is a, she from the kitchen howls out, the spoon is in the saucer! Spoon is in the saucer, as if I can't see it. And you take the spoon and you can't hold the spoon like that. So you do what the spoon should do. So clockwise 3 times, anti-clockwise 4 times, and then sideways and lengthwise. All the time you are howling at her that you can't put sugar on her, that sugar is not going to. And then lifted the cup. There is param shanti, utter peace, complete silence, total satisfaction. It is at that time, if that woman is really a Hindu woman, she will cry out from the kitchen, you want more sugar? does that, you can understand, it's a Hindu woman, ready to serve the husband. When utter silence has come, you know that is, you have put the shoe, it is nothing, it is... They will ask the question. Now here it is. The sugar was in the cup, and yet there was no taste, because it was not shaken. It's only on shaking that the sugar dissolves and goes between every molecule of the water, liquid in it, that it is on the top, middle and the bottom of the same texture of sweetness, and there is total satisfaction. Okay? Into the cup of your head. 15 chapters of the Gita has been put there. Yet your life is as bitter, no sweetness at all. Why? It has not been shaken. That shaking is done by the spoon of the mind. In the intellect you have got all the ideas. But it doesn't add sweetness to your thoughts, your ideas, your concepts, your vision, your imagination, no? It's all selfish at this moment. Shake it. Shake it with the mind, clockwise and anti-clockwise. That is called a reflection. You have to independently think about it. That is why I insisted that you must write the three gunas. Have you written? Is it here with you or in the room? It is here. No. Why? When you thus make you to think for yourself and discover the ideas, it becomes sweeter. I mean, it becomes dissolved. The knowledge that has been put therein dissolves and sort of adds a new glow to every thought that rises in your mind, and these thoughts expressed out in the world outside is called your actions. So the etat buddhva, having known this, meaning put into your cup, into your head, buddhiman syad, may you become sweetened in your intellectual thoughts by shaking it. Kṛta-kṛtyascha bhārata, and come to experience in life kṛta-kṛtyata, a sense of having done what is to be done.
Yeah. Clap if you want, no problem. Bolo Sadgurunath Maharaj ki jai. So now how to do contemplation today? Two things we have to do in contemplation. Detach from the thoughts of BMI, attach to the truth. So we will use Nirvana Shatkam today, the famous composition of Shankaracharya. Every shloka, there are three lines of negation of who I am not, because that's our deep-rooted identification. And last line is to assert who I am. So, mano, buddhi, hankara, chittani, naham. I am not the mind, I am not the intellect, I am not the memory, I am not the ego. Nacha shrotra jihve, nacha ghrana netra. I am not the sense organs. Nacha vyoma bhumirna tejo na vayu. I am not the five elements. Then who am I? Chidananda rupa, shivaham shiva. What one has to do is, before you have to listen to this whole Nirvana Shatkam, understand the implication, significance and all that. In contemplation, no logical analysis, verbalization, understanding, none of that. That has to be finished before. That is manan, shravan and manan. In Nididhyasana, you only use the verse and lift the mind to that state. That's what has to be done in contemplation. No long explanations. And that's why it is subtle and not very easy to do. But one can start. And as one becomes more and more ready, this will become deeper and deeper. So with the intellect, what I know is jnana, and with the mind which I feel is the bhakti. When both these come together, the jiva bhav that I have, that will go. And that will transform into brahma bhav, which is what we call as the contemplation, or that happens in my heart. So what we are trying to do is to transform the jiva bhav into brahma bhav. I feel I am limited, I am bound, I am this individual. That feeling has to go. And by feeling I don't mean emotional feeling only. It's a intuitive grasp that I have, not today. I am a man, I am a woman. It's an intuitive understanding, not a verbal thought. That intuitive understanding has to change. That is what contemplation is all about. When I use those passages and I tell myself again and again and again that I am that, I am not this, my thoughts will change, my intuitive understanding also will change. So, Gurudev is to say that contemplation is feeling fully what you have understood and understanding fully what you have felt. So, integration of intellect and the mind is called heart, and that's what is contemplation. So, the method of contemplation is very simple. We will choose a passage, whichever is inspiring. Very important is you have to memorize it. So if you can't memorize all the 6 verses, doesn't matter. One verse. It doesn't even have to be in Sanskrit. Even English translation is good enough. Sanskrit has a different feel to it, different vibration to it. But if you find it difficult, use English, doesn't matter. Why memorizing is important? Because after all the methods, steps I have done to withdraw my attention and sit quietly and make the mind quiet, my objective is to go beyond BMI. If I don't memorize, I have to again open the book and see entire effort of withdrawing gone. So I have to memorize it. It can even be one line, Aham Brahmasmi. But choose something which will negate and assert both. Because right now we are not ready only for assertion. So any composition which will give both, negate what I am not, assert who I am. Repeat that passage slowly. And when you repeat that, lift the mind to the state that it conveys. And just stay there. Nothing more needs to be done. Don't analyze, don't logically think, don't say what is the meaning of this, none of that. Just use the passage, lift the mind to that state, stay there. If the mind gets distracted, wandering, any of that happens, bring it back to the chanting of the passage and again lift the mind. This has to be done. If you find that is difficult to again lift the mind to that state, come back to your mantra japa. That earlier step which we followed, mantra japa, do that. Again, if the mind becomes ready, go back to contemplation. So that way you will know what to do depending on what is your state of mind at that point in time. So there are different ways to choose the passage. You can choose the passage from the scriptures, from the Upanishads, from the writing of the saints. What is important is it must be positive and inspiring to you. What you want to imbibe very deeply. And the shorter it is, easier it is to memorize, and it goes deeper. Definitely choose about 5 to 10. Start with 5 if you like. Memorize 5 passages. Because mind tends to make certain things mechanical. So 6 days if you do Nirvana Shatkam, 7th day the mind will become mechanical. So switch it with something else. Brahma Gyanavali or anything if you want Sanskrit. Otherwise there are English passages also which are there. There is a nice book of Eknath Ishwaran called Selections from Passages in the World Literature or something like that. That's the name of the book. He has given lots of passages from different cultures also, from Sufi, from Buddhist, from Mirabai, from Gita, from Upanishads. He has collected lots of passages, nice ones, English ones. He has written that in English. You can use that if you like. So here I have given a few suggestions from our scriptures. These are very nice passages. Some nice mantras of the Upanishads, Nirvana Shatkam, 10 verses of contemplation on Vivek Chudamani, Brahma Gyanavali is again a famous one. Asangoham, asangoham. Next week we will do that. Asangoham, asangoham. Asangoham punah punah. So that way you can choose any of these which you like and we can use that for contemplation. Right. I am sending you the PowerPoint of this, the PDF file of this. So don't worry, many of you are so hassled. Arre, ye slide chala gaya, arre. It will come to you anyway, that link comes na, in the email I send. So don't worry. Right.